Good evening. Welcome. Before we begin with Professor Messner's presentation, each spring we begin the evening with the honoring the recipients of the Edith Mueller Scholarship. Edie Mueller was a Parks and Recreation major at the University of Minnesota during the early 1980s until her untimely death in May of 1982. Her parents, Mike and Van Mueller, who could not be with us this evening, have established a fitting tribute to the vitality and purposefulness of their daughter's life. The Edie Mueller Scholarship encourages undergraduates pursuing recreation degrees in park and leisure studies committed to this area of academic study and practical professional practice. We'd like to welcome the sister of Edie Mueller, Carrie Fritz, who is with us this evening on behalf of her sister and the Mueller family. Carrie. I am happy to present this year's scholarship recipients, Megan Lunzer and Miles Cudworth. Megan? Megan enjoyed playing sports as a child. The town where she grew up did not have a strong parks and recreation program, so she had to go to nearby suburbs where they offered the program that she wanted to participate in. It was not until Megan took a job at Matthews Park in Minneapolis that she realized what an impact having a strong recreation program could have on an entire community. Although her original intention when she became a student at the University of Minnesota was to get a degree and a high-paying job in perhaps law or pharmacy, she came to realization that those careers would not make her happy. She made the decision to pursue a degree in recreation in order to provide, in her words, an unbiased, nurturing, accepting environment that allows individuals to discover their own true happiness through recreation experiences they may not have experienced before, while portraying the characteristics, understanding, openness, and desire to serve others. Megan's career goal is to become the director of a Parks and Recreation program. Congratulations, Megan. And Miles. And Miles. Miles has a passion for the outdoors. Growing up at summer camps, family trips to the Boundary Waters, and his volunteer work at Camp Widgiewagon, Wilderness Inquiry, and the Muscular Dystrophy Association has fueled that passion and has led him to want to devote his career to sharing those experiences with others. He believes that participation in recreation activities, staying active, and connected to the outdoors is essential to a person's health and well-being. Miles will be doing an internship this summer with Three Rivers Park District in the final phase of his recreation degree. His plans then are to pursue a career as a recreation director in either a municipal or regional park system. Congratulations, Miles. Again, we would like to thank Mike and Van Mueller, Carrie, and the family for providing the scholarship in remembrance of Edie and her passion for the field of recreation. The Tucker Center would not exist today without the vision and leadership provided by Professor Mary Jo Kane. She is a full professor in the School of Kinesiology and serves as the center's first and only director. Professor Kane received her PhD from the University of Illinois with an emphasis in sports sociology. She is an internationally recognized scholar who has published extensively on the media's stereotypic treatment of athletic females. She is known as an expert in the passage and impact of Title IX. In 1996, Professor Kane was awarded the first distinguished professorship related to women's in sport, the Distinguished McNeil Tucker Chair for Women in Sports and Exercise Science. Professor Kane was elected by her peers as a fellow in the American Academy of Kinesiology, the highest honor in her field. She was inducted into the Academy in 2004. Also in 2004, she received the Scholar of the Year Award from the Women's Sports Foundation. This award is given to researchers who make a significant research contribution in the area of women's sports. In 2007, Professor Kane was named one of the 100 most influential sports educators by the Institute for International Sport. It is my pleasure to recognize and introduce to you Professor Mary Jo Kane.
Thank you, Dr. Magnuson. Excuse me. Before I begin the introduction of our distinguished speaker tonight, I want to thank you all for coming to the presentation. I also want to let you know that there will be a reception right after Professor Messner's remarks in what I know will be a thought-provoking question and answer session. The Tucker Center started this distinguished lecture series, which remains the first and only one of its kind in the nation, in the mid-1990s, under the leadership of our then dean and current president, Robert Brunix. Over the years, we have received enormous support from key individuals and academic units throughout the University of Minnesota, and without their support, we would not have been able to be as successful as we are and to thrive. So I would like to acknowledge just a few people in the audience who have long supported our efforts. I didn't see her here, but she is typically here. There's light in my face. Is Shirley Garner here, who's the associate dean in the graduate school? Shirley, are you here? Okay. I would like to acknowledge the Dean of the College of Education and Human Development, Jean Quam, and hold your applause. I just want these people to stand and then you can applaud. So Jean Quam is up there. Richard Burbach, who's the Development Officer, also in the College of Education, he's right here. And finally, Jim Terman, who is the Assistant Vice Provost and the Director of Recreational Sports. How about a round of applause? Shirley. I hadn't seen him up there, but Joel Maturi, who is the Director of Intercollegiate Athletics. Joel Maturi, our AD. Hey, Joel, where are you? All right, way to go. I also would like to acknowledge members of the Tucker team for all of the hard work that they do behind the scenes to make this such a terrific event. Aaron Becker, Jonathan Sweet, Chelsea Thule, Austin Calhoun, and Nicole Lavoie. How about a round of applause for the Tucker team? And finally, I'd like to acknowledge one of the newest members of the Tucker team, co-director and professor Maureen Weiss. Where is Mo? Okay, Mo. In yesterday's Star Tribune, reporter Rachel Blount made a series of interesting observations about our topic tonight. For politicians and marketing directors, soccer moms wield enormous influence in 21st century America. Corporations are keenly aware of their buying power, and candidates covet the votes of these highly active and passionately engaged women. But soccer moms, and women overall, remain sidelined when it comes to perhaps the most obvious setting for them of all, sports in general and youth sports in particular. Many of you already know this, but one unintended consequence of the passage of Title IX in 1972 has been the dramatic decline in the number of female coaches. Prior to that landmark legislation, at both the college and high school levels, over 90% of all head coaching positions in women's sports nationwide were occupied by females. Today, that number is approximately 46%. This pattern is also true in one of the most influential institutions in this country, youth sports, where female head coaches occupy only about 15% of all head coaching positions. In sum, males continue to dominate leadership positions throughout the vast sport landscape. Into this critical leadership gap comes our distinguished speaker, Professor Mike Messner. And there are few scholars around the globe who are more qualified to do so. Professor Messner received his PhD in sociology from the University of California, Berkeley in 1985. He is professor of sociology and gender studies at the University of Southern California and currently serves as president-elect of the Pacific Sociological Association. He is past president of the North American Society for the Sociology of Sport and the two-time winner of that organization's book award. In 2006, Professor Messner received the Outstanding Senior Faculty Award for Research, Teaching, and Service from the University of Southern California. And in 2007, he was named one of the 100 most influential sports educators by the Institute for International Sports. An internationally renowned and prolific scholar, Professor Messner is author or editor of 11 books, including Taking the Field, Women, Men, and Sports, and Out of Play, Critical Essays on Gender and Sports. His newest book, It's All for the Kids, Gender, Families, and Youth Sports, provides provocative and important insights into the current culture of youth sports. His groundbreaking book examined a Southern California community's youth soccer, baseball, and softball leagues, and he asked the following questions. What barriers prevent women from coaching youth sports? What challenges are faced by the few women who do coach? And what strategies do these women to develop and thrive as youth sport coaches? In tonight's presentation, Professor Messner explores these critical questions and also highlights why recruiting and supporting female coaches is so important for our families, communities, and most of all, for our children. Please join me in giving a warm Minnesota welcome to Professor Mike Messner.
Thank you very much for that warm welcome, and I want to thank Mary Jo Kane in particular for this for that nice introduction, and I want to thank also Nicole Lavoie for in helping invite me and facilitate this visit, and also for the tremendous help that she gave me as I was working on my project. We had some very useful give and take on our mutual research interests, and also want to acknowledge Mo Weiss, whose work has really been foundational in youth sports, and in particular has written some of the most important articles over the years on coaching, women in coaching. And I'm going to talk today about my latest book, as Mary Joan Caden said, but I want to mention too first that I was actually I delivered this lecture here 10 years ago. Well, not this lecture. I'm actually going to do a new lecture here today. But I actually was the distinguished lecturer here for the Tucker Center 10 years ago, almost to the day. And I remember then feeling very honored to have been invited to deliver this lecture. And if anything, it's even more of a thrill now to have been invited to do this. Although I think, I look more distinguished than I did back then due to my grayer hair, the Tucker Center has actually gotten, in that decade, bigger and stronger and more influential than ever, and I can't say that about myself, I think, probably, it's truly become and it's well known across the country that the Tucker Center is really the hub now for anybody who's interested in any research or community development work in girls and women's sports, and so it's really a great honor to be connected with the Tucker Center today. My research on this project really started, or my interest in it started back in the mid-90s when I first went to my oldest son's first soccer practice, and I found that he had a female coach, and I was really delighted to find that. This would have been back in the early to mid-90s. And then as I continued on with him for a couple of years in soccer and baseball and basketball, and then my younger son started playing couple years after that and played a couple years of soccer, a couple years of basketball, and then lots of years of baseball, Little League baseball, my son's never had a female coach again. And I realized that one coach that my first son had was a bit of an aberration, and there I started to notice that there were very, very few coaches, women coaches, around, and that really kind of tweaked my sociological imagination, because I knew and I could see around me that it was a different world than I had lived in the 50s and 60s when I played Little League, and it was just all for boys. There are obviously lots of girls out there playing all of these sports, and a lot of these moms had played sports and had were really kind of products of Title IX themselves. And so it really was very interesting to me to find that there were so few women's sports. So I started to kind of wonder why that was, and I started to develop some research interest in that. And one of the things that first happened when I first started talking to people about this, I one of my first interviews, I asked a woman who was coaching, why do you think it is that there are so few women coaches? And she said, well, and she kind of laughed, she says, well, yeah, we don't like chick coaches too much in this town, do we? She went on to explain that she, in fact, was very stubborn and had continued to coach for several years, but she felt as though she and a lot of the other women had faced some real serious barriers to getting into coaching, and then once in had some difficulties that were related to not being viewed or not being respected by some of the other members of the community and some of the other coaches. But one of the things I want to do in this talk is kind of use some of the voices of the women coaches that I interviewed, and kind of used some of the interview material to give you a sense of the flavor of the women coaches that I interviewed, and there are a lot of other aspects to this study, including a lot of interviews with men coaches, and that I'm not really including here today. And I want to say, sort of as a parenthetical caveat here, that you're getting kind of one side of this picture, but one thing, and I'll mention this a little bit later, is that even though some of the things you're going to hear that the women say don't make a lot of the men sound so supportive and helpful, there were some very supportive and helpful men, and some of the women coaches credited individual men with recruiting them, mentoring them, and so forth. So it's certainly not a picture of a community of bad guys who are trying to keep the women out, and in fact, I think a lot of what goes on is a lot more subtle than that. So what I started to do is collect, at first, I started to just collect numbers, and I was looking at AYSO in my community, which is South Pasadena, California, and Little League baseball and softball in the same community. And I started just collecting each year data on how many of the coaches were women. And as you can see, the line for Little League baseball is quite low, and it was pretty flat for all of those years. And the data for the AYSO was fairly flat for most of that time, but then in the last 3 years of the study, 4 years of the study, it started a steady climb, and I still have not been able to get my hands on the 2008 data. I'd love to see if that climb continued, so as not to necessarily conclude that that's a stairway to heaven. I think that it's important to note that I did pick up an old 1994 yearbook from this AYSO league, and that year over 19% of the coaches were women, so it's not unprecedented for it to have gone that high before it dipped down for several years. But baseball and softball and soccer are different in some ways, and I can talk about that a little bit, and I'll kind of give you some hints at things I'm willing to talk about a little bit more in the Q&A as I go along that I don't have time to include in the actual presentation here today. So what I did, and just to kind of in terms of if you're interested in the methods, over the course of several years, I did a content analysis of the annual yearbooks from these two leagues, and that's the data that I just showed you there pretty much comes from that content analysis. And I just sort of counted where the women, how many of them are there, where are they placed, in what age groups, are they coaching boys, are they coaching girls, and so forth. And I did lots of field observations, went to practices, a lot of games, went to coaches' clinics, tryouts, opening ceremonies. And in my community, the annual opening ceremony for the AYSO league is particularly amazing. It seems like everybody in the whole town is out there, and our U.S. congressman comes and everything. It's quite a big public event. And then I did a lot of participant observation, mostly of boys' Little League baseball, even though I was studying girls' softball and also studying soccer, and this was just only because this is what my son played, and so I ended up just being there a lot. And I was assistant coached a lot, and worked as a scorekeeper for his team and that sort of thing. So I had a good vantage point for studying baseball from T-ball all the way up through the 13, 14-year-old age groups. And in terms of the participant observation part, the sort of observation part, I didn't as systematically get the field observations of the other sports as much as I did with Little League Baseball. Then I had also 50 in-depth interviews with women and men coaches, about half women and half men, and spread across baseball, softball, soccer. And some of these people I interviewed had, you know, coached multiple sports. Some of them would coach AYSO during one season, and softball or baseball in another season, sometimes basketball too. So they were very... very active volunteer coaches. And I asked, as I told you at the beginning, first and foremost, how is it that in this day and age that there are so few women head coaches? And there are really two parts to that answer. And the first part is that it's important to look at the entry level of the sort of pipeline. If, you know, people who study occupational segregation, whether you're talking about racial segregation or sex segregation in certain occupations, talk about an occupational career path as a pipeline. And at the beginning, there's sort of, you know, education and training, and then getting some sort of mentoring and entering into the early career of the pipeline, and then moving on up. And people who look at women in occupations talk about that, about the beginning of the pipeline, and then leaky pipelines, women kind of falling out of the pipeline along the way for various reasons. So I looked pretty carefully at how is it that women get into coaching when they do, and what is it that prevents women from getting into youth coaching, because so few actually do get into it. And that's not something that I'm going to talk about here today too much, but I'd be willing in Q&A if you want me to give you a quick overview of that part of it. What I'm going to talk about more today is that question number two, is what happens to the women who do get into coaching? What they find, as I'll outline in more detail, is that they face a very chilly climate that makes them feel less than comfortable, and they face a kind of glass ceiling. So you see a lot of women kind of going in for a year or two, kind of bumping up against that glass ceiling and staying down below it or clearing out. So their career paths for those who get into, and I'm calling this a career loosely because, as you know, it's a volunteer activity. It's not like a paid career. But the career trajectories, I developed these three patterns. And the first one I call stoppers, and it's women who just go in and coach for 1 year, sometimes maybe 2 years, and then they quit, they get out. The second pattern is what I call cyclers, and it's women who go in, coach a year or two for their young child, maybe 6, 7 to maybe the 8 year old, and then they cycle back and start with a younger sibling at age 5, 6 again, and just stay in, and they might cycle 2 or 3 times if they have 2 or 3 kids, but stay down there in those young age levels. And then the third pattern is what I call gamers, and these are the women who really push through the glass ceiling, coach for several years, and move on up through the age ranks and coach the older kids. They are very, very few and far between. I interviewed everyone I could find, but essentially the dominant pattern, looking at the both of these leagues over the course of all of these years I've studying it, the dominant pattern is stoppers. There's a lot of women who just coach 1 or 2 years and get out. And then the second most common pattern is cyclers, and more so in soccer. And then the very rare pattern is the gamers, and they're almost all in soccer. 1 or 2 of them are in girls' softball, but most of them are in soccer. So what you end up with really is a kind of glass ceiling holding women, and it's invisible. You know, you can't. It's not like there's formal rules to say women can't move beyond this position, but an informal glass ceiling that's structured along these three lines. And one is the age of the kids' teams. You see very few women coaching kids over age 9. Most of them are clustered into younger age groups, and they're usually stoppers or cyclers in those younger age groups. You also see that second dimension, the sex of the kids' teams. Very few women coaching boys' teams. The third is the sport. very few women coaching baseball. And so older boys' baseball teams, no women at all. And I'll talk a little bit more about that later. Women clustered more in soccer, softball, girls' softball, and at the younger ages. So you see that kind of segregation, I guess you'd say. So that's kind of just the background of the study. And what I'm going to talk about here today are these four points. One is, what are the particular gender challenges that women coaches face? And the term gender challenge, I'm borrowing from the sociologist James Messerschmidt, who talks about how in various sort of institutional contexts, families, workplaces, schools, and so forth, people face these sort of challenges that are structured around the idea of gender that force them to kind of negotiate their way into and sometimes out of institutions. The second is I'm going to look at what are the strategies, what are the dominant strategies that women coaches deploy to face these gender challenges, and I want to talk about what the limitations of these strategies are. And in this part, I'm going to talk more about kind of individual strategies that individual women deploy to try to survive and sometimes thrive within the coaching field that's, as I said, kind of a chilly climate for many of them. Then third, I'm going to talk about what kinds of group and organizational changes can be made in youth sports. And here I'm going to draw both on what some things that I think are already happening or that are hinted at in some of the things that people are doing in youth sports, and others that just sort of are logical extensions of my research that I don't necessarily see people doing yet. And then finally, at the end, I'm going to talk a little bit about why it matters. And I imagine with this group, it may seem that not important to talk necessarily about why it matters, but I want to get up on my soapbox for a little minute at the end, and it may be that some of my reasons why I say it matters are ones that some of you haven't thought about, even if you already think it's a good idea for there to be more women coaches. So the part one here, the gender challenges, I'm going to talk about three gender challenges that women coaches very commonly face. One is just what I call gendered scrutiny, and the way that women feel that men sometimes challenge indirectly or sometimes directly their qualifications and abilities. The second is what I call the secret language of male coaches that women are often not privy to. And this is a term that I got from one of the women who I interviewed, as you'll see. And that helps to sort of informally create this glass ceiling that the women face. And the third challenge I'm going to mention is body politics, the use of bodies and voices on the field and the way women respond to the way men kind of move about the field and use their voices. Now, in terms of gendered scrutiny, one of the things that's important to note, I think, is that almost all of the coaches that I interviewed talked about when they first got into coaching, they were reluctant to do it. And it's really interesting because most of these people are highly accomplished people. They're adults, they're, you know, in their 30s, 40s, even a few of them in their early 50s. They're very, for the most part, very confident-seeming people. Yet when you first started talking to them about getting into youth sport coaching, how did you first decide to do it? The vast majority of them talked about feeling insecure, lacking confidence in their ability to coach a group of 6 and 7 year olds. And when we'd ask them why, and I say we because I had a research assistant, Suzelle Bozada-Diaz, who did some of the interviews, when we asked them why, it wasn't that they were worried about the kids. They were really worried about these folks here. It's the adults, the families in the community, the adults, the other parents. They are really concerned about the fact that coaches, that they know that they're going to be under a tremendous amount of scrutiny from their neighbors, from the people who live in the town, from the parents of the kids on their team and on other teams. And parents can be very judgmental of coaches. And in this case, as I said, this is just volunteer activity. So a lot of parents thought, do I really want to put up with that? So I think both women and men, with the exception of very few men who just seem to have all of this confidence that they could do it no matter what, but even the vast majority of the men seemed to have to struggle with this. But I think it's also the case that the women were aware that they were going to have to face a particular kind of scrutiny that I would call gendered scrutiny, that questions their abilities simply because they're women, that they're under a spotlight, they're under a certain kind of surveillance from the community and from the other parents and the other coaches and maybe the umpires even, or referees, simply because they're women. And they're very aware of that going into it, that they're going to be under that kind of scrutiny. And throughout here, I'm going to sometimes draw connections to the experiences that women have when they move in as pioneers into other occupations, you know, the first woman lawyer in a law firm, the first woman doctor in a medical field, and that sort of thing. I think that kind of the way that sort of new sort of token person stands out, it puts you under a microscope, and a lot of these women knew this very much going in. So that gendered scrutiny, and here's where I'm going to get into some of the interview material. And when I put some of these up here, I'm not going to read the entire thing aloud to you because otherwise it would take me too long, and you know, you can kind of read some of this as you go. But Barbara Jones, who is a soccer coach, made a sort of a general point about this about a sort of double standard of scrutiny. She says, you know, when you're a man coach, particularly of boys, there's a presumption he knows what he's doing, and there's no question. And when they're complete, even when they're complete blithering idiots as coaches, because I've seen that too, she said. And when you're a woman, if you get that same presumption, you kind of have to prove yourself. And I think that's something that came out a lot in the interviews with the women, is this sense that you have to prove yourself, and then you have to sort of prove yourself over and over again. And again, the men felt some of that, but think of a sort of common feeling that the women and the men coaches had, but then it's kind of amplified 3-4 times for the women because of this sort of gendered scrutiny that they're under. And then Joan Ring, a soccer coach, gives an example here of being called up by a father on the phone at the beginning of the season who asks her what her qualifications are, and then she talks about him being, oh, he was just an aggressive attorney, and then another aggressive attorney, she says, would question things I would do, even though I don't think he knew anything about soccer. Like if I ran a drill, he'd say, are you sure that's in the drill book, or is that a real drill? So she felt that, you know, she was constantly, you know, not from all of the fathers and from not all of the men, but that each year she coached, she said, and she was a gamer, she coached for many years, each year she coached, she could count on there being at least one or two guys who would challenge her and question her and make her sort of prove her abilities. There's another sort of level of this scrutiny, I think, that I just call bad vibes, and it's not overt discrimination. It's not something where the guys are kind of trying to undercut you or do something wrong to you. But as you can see from these two quotes from soccer coaches, it's more a general feeling that the men who are the opposing coaches don't like to lose to a woman. You know, Carol Morris, a soccer coach, says, it's not their girls losing a game to our girls. It's like they're losing to me, and I'm a girl. And the last thing they want to do is lose to a girl. And then she says, I get that feeling from two coaches. And when we asked her, you know, how do they give you those feelings? She says, you can just tell. You can just tell. And the same kind of thing with Shelley Parsons, who talks about a coach, male coaches who have a hard time losing to a female. And she says, I just sense it. You can just sense it. So these are some things that, you know, kind of are being felt below the surface. And they're also the kind of thing that some women coaches would, it leads them to kind of wonder, am I being paranoid? Is he just like that to everybody? Or is it just because I'm a woman? Because if you're out there just as an individual, you don't really know. But there's also a tendency, you know, when you hear this sort of thing in a lot of different interviews, you realize there's a pattern operating here, and that they're actually reading something in the response of the men coaches. Another thing that came up in several women's interviews was problems with male assistant coaches. And this first one, Pam Burke, basically said she doesn't have an assistant coach most of the time because she says men don't want to be assistant coaches to a woman. And sometimes there are some men who would want to do it for the right reasons, she said. But there's also the kind of man who wants to take over. And he says, well, my boy's got a woman coach. I better get in there and, you know, do this right. And she said she'd rather just not have an assistant coach than have someone like that. And I, you know, I'd heard in my interviews of a guy who was asked to coach 1 year in baseball, and he said he didn't want to that year, and then he found out that his son was going to be on a woman's team, and he immediately volunteered to coach and took his son off of that woman's team and formed his own team. And then Kate Kaplan, who is a young woman who is a softball coach, and talked about basically getting pushed around a lot by her assistant coach, and she said he would change the positions around and totally mess everything up, and then I was constantly like battling to get my feedback or my opinion in, you know. And then Joan Ring, a quote that I think is probably the most humorous one, she says, "Here's how bad it got. The ref came up to me and said, 'Is this guy annoying you?' And I laughed and said, 'Yeah, he is, but there's nothing we can do about it. He's my assistant coach.'" So, and she, as I told you before, was a gamer, and there were a couple of, since I did the study for several years, she came up to me a couple times and even sent me an email like 2 years after I interviewed her and said, "I've got another assistant coach I've got to tell you about." So this was an ongoing issue for her. The other point that I want to raise, just, and this is also still under this level of the kind of this category of challenges that women are facing, is what's called the secret language of male coaches. And again, this comes from an interview from Kate Kaplan, who I introduced to you a second ago. And she is a younger woman who was a PE coach, very experienced softball player, and she thought, sure, I can just jump right in there and coach girls softball. And it was a very, very rude awakening to her. She says, "I know the basics of softball, and I know how to teach the girls all the rules and play the game and strategy and all that stuff, but I just felt like I never had enough information. Like, I felt the other coaches were speaking a secret language. It's weird. It's hard to explain. I mean, it's like..." She takes a deep breath and says, "like walking into a room and these people already all know each other and you don't know anybody and they're nice to you, but they don't tell you the kind of things that will help you become a better coach, like, you know, etiquette or the unwritten rules, I guess." And then I asked her, "how did that make you feel?" And she said, "I was very frustrated. I was very stressed. I just felt this big, small, like I could never measure up and I could never be the coach. I never felt good. I felt like I sucked. Like everyone's looking at me saying, 'Kate Kaplan is the worst coach ever.' She was a stopper. She coached 1 year and got out." And she talked a lot about what she felt to be, you know, just an informal sort of dynamic of a kind of, she used the term old boys network, that the guys were very friendly with each other, and they were kind of nice enough to her. It's not like anybody was mean to her, but she never felt kind of included in the in-group. And a lot of people know this, you know, when again, sort of comparing to other occupations, that you sort of learn certain things in school about, you know, being a lawyer or being whatever occupation that is you're going into. But a lot of the most important learning is informal, through mentors, through learning on the job, learning the informal sort of dynamics of what your workplace demands and so forth. And so if you're somebody who's different and you move into an occupation, you're educated in the technicalities of that occupation, like knowing the game of softball, and you even have worked with kids before, having been a PE teacher, it's kind of stunning to find out that there's all this knowledge that you're not privy to, and it makes you feel stupid. It makes you feel like you don't know what you're doing, like you suck. So this idea of the old boys network, I think it came out a lot in the interviews with the women, and it was very interesting because a lot of them talked about there being an old boys network or an inner circle of men who kind of ran everything secretly. And when we interviewed the men, we'd ask them about this, and I even asked some of the men, you know, "Are you in the inner circle?" And nobody would ever say they're in the inner circle. Even the guys who are part of the organizing cabal of Little League or AYSO, you know, the president of AYSO and so forth. No, I'm not in any inner circle. I used to think before I was the president that there was an inner circle, but now I realize that there's not. And there was even a story circulating around with some of the women. We got this from several interviews about baseball, and they said, there's a group of men who meet at Gus's Barbecue, and this is an old bar and grill in town. and they're Little League coaches, and they're the inner circle of Little League, and they meet at Gus's Barbecue, and they make all the major decisions about the league, who's going to coach and what's going to happen with the All-Star team and all that, and they sit at the same table that their fathers sat at when they were running the Little League, you know, 30 years ago. And we tried really hard to explore this and find, and we asked everybody we could interview, all the men we interviewed about this. Nobody seemed to be able to corroborate that this actually happened. But we thought it was interesting, even if it didn't happen, that the story was circulating because it gave a certain sort of form to the feeling, the vague feeling that a lot of the women had, that there was this inner circle that was running everything. And these three men are not part of the inner circle at all, I want to tell you. So here's a couple, I'm going to give you a couple examples of women who are intuiting some inner circle and feeling the effects of it, but can't really point to it and say that there's a there. Maybe they guess that it's happening at Gus's Barbecue, but they don't really know for sure. And this is Ellen Lessing, who I should mention at the outset is a she was a cycler. She was, you know, 51 or 2 years old. She had a law degree and was a professor, very accomplished, very powerful woman. And here's her story. She says, "I wasn't chosen to coach." And she'd already been a coach for her younger child's, when she was trying to move up to the next level. "And I don't know what it was. A man coach called and said, 'We have too many coaches.' And I said, 'Fine,' and stepped out. Later, I felt it was because there were so many men and not many women. And I thought, there might be, you know, kind of the old boys choosing their friends. I have felt squeezed out. And it very easily plays into my insecurities, and so I easily bow out." And she started to sob here, and she said, "So even this year, I didn't sign up to coach her older daughter's team. I signed up for the younger son's team." And she's struggling as she cries, and she says, "Because it's easier psychologically, you know, to just not be with all those men." Now, it's interesting, a couple weeks ago, as I was assembling this presentation, this PowerPoint, I got an email from a woman in Canada who had gotten a hold of my book, and in her email, she said almost the same thing that Ellen Lessing said. These are all pseudonyms, by the way. But she said the same thing. She said, "You know, I was coaching my daughter's team, and I wanted to move up to the age 8 and 9 level, and I just found out today I wasn't chosen, and I'm so upset by this." And then she said something similar to Ellen Lessing, though. "I wasn't really sure why it was. I don't know if this is really discrimination or not, because as you move up to the next level, there are actually fewer teams, so there are fewer slots for coaches. So maybe it's just that I was not chosen because I'm not good enough, or was considered not to be good enough." And Ellen Lessing said something similar. "Maybe it's just because, you know, I wasn't good enough, and it tweaks my insecurities and realize maybe I wasn't as strong a coach as some of these guys. But then I look at who they picked, and I realize it's all men, and the few women that were there have been dropped out. And that as the pyramid narrows at the top, it becomes all men, even the women who wanted to stay in." So she then cycles back and stays with a younger sibling. A similar one, June Park, also a very accomplished woman, woman in her mid-40s. She's a teacher. And she says of the men in the community, she says, "They're all friends. I mean, they basically grew up together, and they all went to high school together." I think she might have had one of the people who thought the Gus's Barbecue as well. "They're still here. Their families are here, and now their kids are here. And when I started, I was like some Pollyanna that thought, you know, men and women, they just do things equally. And that's the way it is. When it comes to sports, it just turned out to be some kind of backroom boys club. I don't know what they make of women coaches anymore. I mean, they include me in social things, but then they exclude me from these coaching positions." So again, kind of a vague feeling. I mean, what she had was a feeling of exclusion, but not a clear sense about how and why that process happens. Now, it's especially powerful in baseball, and as several of the moms said who we asked, who were actually coaches, we'd ask them about coaching baseball, and most of them said, "There's no way. The men own baseball. Baseball is not something that I would do. And Nancy Morris even says, "I don't think there's a woman out there who has the guts to go out and try to coach baseball and step up there and coach. I certainly wouldn't do it." And so again, to the extent that there's a sense of an old boys network, it's especially powerful in boys baseball. Now, the third element of the boundaries or challenges that women coaches face is just what I call generally body politics. And this first quote by Pam Burke, a soccer coach, is talking about men basically using their bodies on the field in the coaching box to kind of push her out of the way, running right through her. And she said that my kids couldn't even hear me trying to, coach them, and that was a horrible experience. Joan Ring, the bottom quote, says, "I guess I felt like I was at a disadvantage. They were screaming and their voices are so penetrating, and your voice is just," and she makes a high whiny sound, and she says, you get drowned out. And a lot of the women talked about their decisions to cycle back, the cyclers especially, that they did not, they went and watched the 10, 11, 12-year-old games, and they saw how loud the men had gotten, how much they were yelling, and they said, "I don't want to have to deal with that. I would rather not have to compete with my voice with that. I'm going to stay with the younger kids." Or some of them said, "I don't want to deal with it at all," and got out. So this sense of feeling like you can't get your voice out there, you can't get respect because the men are kind of drowning you out with their voices and with their bodies. So when we think about all of these kind of strategies and barriers that women coaches talk about that kind of make up a glass ceiling and make it a chilly climate for them, it's interesting that when we ask people, why do you think it is that there are so few women coaches, this is the most common answer we got, not just from the men, but from some of the women as well. They give opportunities to everyone to manage or coach, and it just so happens no women volunteer, It's as simple as that. And the explanation that people fall back on, at least initially when you ask them this question, is based on this idea of individual choice, individual volunteerism. Since it's an open system, since anybody can volunteer, then the people we end up getting are the people who chose to volunteer. And I think this is where, for my taste, a sociological perspective is so valuable, is because one of the key elements of sociology and contributions of sociology is that we understand that people do make choices, but people make choices within contexts. People make choices within structured contexts that constrain the way we think about our choices, and they enable certain choices. So, at a first beginning of the year team meeting or something like that, when the main coach or manager asks for volunteers for the team, and I and some other men raise our hands, and I would say, "Hey, I'll volunteer. I'll do anything you want me to." And they throw me a hat and say, "You're an assistant coach." And a woman raises her hand and says, "I'll do anything you want me to too." And he says to her, "Yeah, you'll be our team mom then." There's these kinds of informal mechanisms that structure people's choices and options, I think. So moving then to the gender strategies, because the women coaches that I interviewed, that I came to think of many of them as really heroic, and they were very innovative in a lot of ways, and they hung in there, some of them, and some of them hung in there only a year or two, and some of them hung in there for years and thrived, and some of them did quite well as coaches. I tried to figure out a little more systematically, how did they do that, given these sort of barriers and challenges that they faced? And I categorized the strategies into these sort of four. One I just call, you gotta be tough. The second is just consciously looking the part. And the third is consciously acting the part. And the fourth, a few women engaged in, especially moving up into higher age groups, they decided that they would co-coach with somebody, and that gave them a little bit of elbow room. So in terms of this sort of you gotta be tough thing, you've heard Joan Ring's quotes a couple times already. As I said, she's a gamer who's been coaching soccer for many years, but has been challenged many times in many ways, including by her assistant coaches. She says, "After our first practice last week, my assistant coach criticized me in front of some parents, and he said, 'Inexperienced coaches always run too many drills.' And I told him that I'm not inexperienced, that I have several years of coaching experience. I took him aside and told him, 'Look, these girls need strong female role models. And out here, that's me. I'm the coach, so you've got to back off, okay?'" So she and some of the other women talked about just basically standing up to men and telling them, getting back in their faces and telling them, I'm the boss here, back off, Buster. But you know, it's not something that women should really have to do, or any coach should really have to do. But in order to hang in there and deal with these gender challenges, this is one of the strategies that the successful women coaches did deploy. Another gamer, Dolores Quintero, who was I admired tremendously. She was a very successful softball coach. She coached for many, many years, won several championships. And she talked about the need to prove yourself. And I asked her especially about umpires, because one of the things I'd observed is that with women managers in softball and even in younger levels of baseball where there are a few women managers, I noticed that umpires would frequently come over, like between an inning, put his arm around the shoulder of the woman manager and give her a little advice, you know. And I thought that looked really condescending to me, and I didn't see umpires doing that with male managers at all. And so I asked some of the women about that, and I asked her about that, and she said, yeah, that happens to me, but it doesn't happen to me very much because I get the jump on the umpires. And she said what she does with a new umpire is that she goes up to the, she checks him out in advance while before the game even starts, and she'll walk over to the umpire and start asking him questions real fast. Have you checked out the bats and balls to make sure they're regulation yet? I was looking at that other team's bats over there. I'm not sure. Would you please go look at those? Because she knows all the rules. And she would check him, and she said, this way, as you can see by the quote, she said, I have my game face on. I'm a very take charge kind of person. I conduct myself appropriately, but I think my manner has somehow made the officials take note that, okay, I think this one maybe knows what she's doing. So she is consciously strategizing out there to try to kind of get the jump a little bit on the and create an impression on a new umpire, a new manager on the other team that she really knows her stuff, and she's not somebody who, and she's somebody who really belongs there. A second strategy is really consciously looking the part. And there's a lot of literature out there on women in corporate America, women in professions, and how conscious they are about how they dress and how they present themselves in their workplace. And you know, as you know, there's this sort of fine line that women professionals often walk between wanting to look presentable in a quote traditionally feminine sort of way, but not too much, because then you're not going to be taken seriously. But if you dress or act in a way that's not feminine enough, people think, well, she's not a real woman, and she's a castrating bitch, and things like that get put on you. And so there's this fine line that women have to very carefully navigate in workplaces. And I found that some of the women coaches were dealing with some of the same kind of thing. One of the things, you know, when people think coach, it's still a very gendered concept that when people imagine a coach, lots of times people still imagine male. So when people are confronted with a female coach, they don't recognize that as a female coach. And I heard a lot of female coaches tell me things like, oh, when we had the team picture taken, the photographer moved me over to the side and put my assistant coach in the middle, thinking it was the coach. And I had to say, no, I'm the coach, you know. And so a lot of sorts of things like that. So making sure you have all the markers of being the coach becomes very important. This photo right here, I took it on the first day of a season. And a month or two later, I interviewed this woman, and I said to her, I noticed that you wear a whistle, but I never saw you use it. And she said, oh, I never blow that whistle. And she says, I just wear it because then people realize I'm the coach. You know, and I never saw anybody else in soccer wearing a whistle. And she, you notice she's also wearing, you know, athletic shoes and shorts, and that is a coaching shirt, which I'll say a little bit more about. And you've seen this photo already once, and this woman coach here has, at least three or four of these guys in the picture are men coaches. She is not wearing the official shirt because there was a 2-year period where the league kind of forgot to buy small size coaching shirts. And so the women told me, you know, I had to decide, should I wear the coaching shirt and have it hang down to my knees? One of them said, not this woman, but one of them said, if I wear the coaching shirt, I'm going to look like I'm pregnant. It's going to hang lower than my shorts. But if I don't wear it, people aren't going to recognize me as the coach. And so what some women did, a couple of them told me, they went and bought their own shirts and had coach printed on it so that people would recognize them as the coach. So they're very aware and strategizing very clearly on how to dress and how to appear and how to look. Another thing is, you know, dealing with the voices on the field and dealing with the fact that there are people out there, men out there, yelling loudly. Again, Joan Ring saying, you know, she was playing a game against a team that had two intense screamers. So she said, so of course I started screaming. But she says, but I've heard parents say that a coach that doesn't talk much to, during a game, they don't think they're very good. They perceive that as disinterest. They want to hear some talking, but of course they don't. They want it to be positive. And now again, all coaches have to deal with this. You want to be engaged. You want to be, you know, communicating with your kids on the field, which it sometimes involves some yelling because you have to project your voice out onto the field. But if you do that too much or the tone of it is too critical, you're going to be seen as a coach that most parents don't want their kids to have. And if you don't yell at all, you're not going to be seen as interested enough. So again, this is a kind of area that all coaches have to navigate. But again, I think that the area is a little bit narrower for women's navigation. And again, with the higher voices that most women have compared to most men, yelling, you risk being criticized for being shrill. And Lillian Moore here, I think her quote is an example of that, where she says she was taken aside after the game and told that she was being too serious. And she was shocked because she said, you know, I feel like I'm kind of a teacher. I'm not the kind of person that stands out there screaming and yelling at people. I stay positive. But I guess supposedly I could look overly serious. So I think that there's a fine line again there that women are navigating on how loud to be, how much to yell, and so forth. The same is true with how competitive you are. And this one's even tougher, I think. And again, quoting Dolores Quintero, who was very successful coach, and she said that the league is very men controlled, and I found some opposition to my competitive nature. And she coached the girls all the way up to the top and won a bunch of championships. And she says, a couple of coaches accused me of having a chip on my shoulder. I remember this happening when I team taught with a woman a couple of times, and the student evaluations would come out and they would say, oh, she seemed to have a chip on her shoulder. And I would say the same thing she said, and nobody saw me as chippy, apparently. So, and she said, but I don't put winning above everything else, but let's face it, you join something, you want to win. I'm an open book. I don't hold back. It's obvious. I'm competitive. And for me to bring it as a woman, I think there were a few men that were threatened. And they told me that I had a chip on my shoulder. I think some of them had a chip on their shoulder because maybe I brought something to the table that they didn't have. So she is the kind of woman who really, you know, kind of beat the men at their own game in a certain way, became even more competitive, and was seen then by some people in the community as being too competitive. So again, that sort of fine line. A fourth sort of strategy that a few women engaged in is co-coaching a team, and usually co-coaching a team with a man, sometime with their husband. And those who did this saw this as a very good strategy for moving up into higher age levels, and they described it as a kind of buffer for them that allowed them to kind of bring to the coaching experience what they wanted without having to, it gave them elbow room, in other words, to kind of coach the way they wanted to and not feel as though they were under the extreme scrutiny that they would have been under as the sole coach of an older kid's team. And I think as all of these strategies go, it also was a very limited strategy. And I want to talk a little bit just about the limits of each of these strategies before I move on to talk about collective and organizational changes. First, I think these individual strategies tend to work well for some of these women. It really helped them navigate a very difficult and tough terrain, hang in there, and sometimes be successful and have their kids recognize them as good coaches and parents appreciate them in some cases. But I think what ends up happening, especially with somebody like Dolores Quintero, who becomes the really overly competitive one and is seen as too competitive, is I think they end up kind of getting positioned as a sort of fictive male rather than being a sort of female pathbreaker that kind of opens the field up for other women. They get sort of stereotyped as somebody who's a sort of honorary male, and in this case, a not very well-liked honorary male. So I think that kind of competitiveness worked for her, but it doesn't really change the system very much at all. In fact, it might end up working the opposite way, and where people might say, well, you know, we had this one woman, she wasn't competitive enough, so she quit. She couldn't take it, she wasn't tough, so she quit. And we had this other woman over here, Quintero, who was way too competitive, and she was just over the top. She couldn't control herself. And see, you know, women probably shouldn't be coaching at this level. So the kind of double standards, I think, operate in ways with dress and comportment, with voice. Do you yell too much or do you not yell enough? Are you competitive enough? Are you too competitive? Sometimes women, individuals, can navigate this, but they certainly don't necessarily change the culture of the league or the organization. And then the third one, the co-coach viewing. One of the examples I have of that is that of going to a game and a girls' softball game and sitting down next to some people I knew, and I told them about my project, and they had been talking about their coach, this guy on the field, as being the greatest coach in the league. And I told them I'm really interested in interviewing women coaches because there aren't very many. And they said, oh, we have a women coach too. They're co-coaches on their husband-wife team. And then I realized, oh, the woman was sitting in the dugout, and I'd actually already interviewed her, but I hadn't seen her yet. And I realized that from the point of view of these parents, the way they had been talking before they heard about my research was they were talking about the man as the team's coach or manager as a softball team. And it didn't come to mind to talk about her until I said I was interested in women coaches. And so it made me wonder if sometimes it works well for the woman to be a co-coach with the man, but it doesn't necessarily change the gender dynamics of the team and the league and the perceptions of the parents if there's a co-coaching sort of thing going on, that it might very well be that she's viewed as his assistant, even though she views herself, and maybe some of the kids recognize that she's actually the co-coach. So these are all just sort of hints at the limitations of what I see as individual strategies. Now, there are group and organizational strategies that I think are much more promising. And again, you know, as a sociologist, I think about group change and structural change and see a lot of limitations to even very heroic kinds of individual strategies that some of the women I interviewed are undertaking. And in terms of group strategies, one of the things that I saw happening out there, especially in soccer, is informal mentorship. There's a lot of women who get into the league and they find a mentor, and it happens informally because there's no formal mentoring system in either of the leagues that I studied. And in some cases, they are being mentored by men, as I mentioned. And there's a great book by Sherry Grassmuck called Stealing Home, where she studies a Little League baseball league in Philadelphia that's in a community that's undergoing a sort of racial ethnic transformation where it's becoming more African American. And she looks at the way baseball sort of facilitates, the Little League baseball facilitates the racial transformation of the town. And she talks about sponsorship, about racial sponsorship, and how some of the white men in the league brought in some of the black men into the coaching and kind of sponsored them and sort of, you know, this guy's okay, he and bring him in, and then everybody thinks, well, since Joe Schmo brought him in, he must be okay. And then eventually, with enough of those sort of moments of sponsorship, you have a cluster of black males starting to work their way into a previously all-male sort of group. And there's some of that sort of happening in AYSO soccer in the organization I studied. There are some of these women who talk about these very good mentors, men who really, in Grassmuck's term, sponsored them. The second thing is that, and I see very little or none of that in baseball. The second thing is the building of what one of the women called an old girls network. They criticize the old boys network, but in soccer, again, you see the development of networks of women starting to talk about recruiting new women coaches, getting together for beers together to talk about their experiences. Mentoring first and second year coaches and so forth, and you see that the beginnings of the development of that kind of networking among some of the women. Again, not so much at all in softball or baseball. Third, I think what's needed and is not really happening much at all is organizational recruitment of assistant coaches. And I haven't talked about this too much, but other than to hint at it, but the way people get in, most people get into head coaching a team is by first via the route of having been an assistant coach. You assistant coach for a year. It helps you sort of understand the league, the rules, the kids, the other coaches, what it entails. You learn some drills. You learn how to run some practices. The following year, you think, this isn't so hard. You sign up to head coach. And what happens is women are not getting pulled into assistant coaching jobs. They're getting diverted away from assistant coaching jobs. So leagues should systematically be pulling women into assistant coach jobs. And then women can decide the following year, 2 years after doing that, that they might want to choose to put their hat in the ring for a head coaching job. The fourth thing is what I call glass ceiling buster classes. And again, AYSO has some of these. And from what I've heard from some of the people who've taken these classes, there's mixed sort of takes on how valuable they are or not. But essentially, if you want to move from coaching, you know, under seven or under six, move up to the next rank to under nine, age groupings, you take a whole separate class that teaches you more about how the rules are going to change for that next level. They teach you things on, you know, different kinds of skills and drills that you need to run for coaching at that level. And the people that I know who took those classes, including some women, say, even though sometimes they didn't like the tenor of them, they felt like they learned enough so that it gave them enough knowledge to move up to that next level. Again, Little League Baseball, at least in my community, doesn't do any of that. They had a coaching clinic just at the beginning of the year for all the coaches, but nothing that's sort of age-related like that that would help people kind of move up to the next level who might feel as though they don't have enough knowledge to do that or enough confidence to do that. And then finally, I think what leagues need to do is to engage in education about informal gender dynamics. It's very similar to the way people talk about race relations these days. They say, well, all of the formal barriers to racial equality have fallen now because of all of the laws now that used to enforce segregation, things like that, no longer exist. So formal discrimination is illegal and so forth. And a lot of that is true, not entirely, but I think a lot of that is true in terms of gender equality as well. But what recreates gender inequality in our society has a lot more to do with informal dynamics, attitudes, sort of informal rituals that we all engage in without thinking. It's not mean and nasty people purposefully discriminating against each other. It's everybody kind of going with the flow and doing the same thing we did last year. So if people can be educated about this, and I have a little list of things that I could, you know, give to league organizers to have them just talk with coaches about just simple things that they can do to try to shift those dynamics and make it more inviting for women to start volunteering. I'm coming in for a landing here pretty soon. I appreciate your attention, and I will make just a few more points here. But what I want to mention here is that there are organizations. There's research that goes way back to 1977. Rosa Beth Moss Kanter, again, drawing a comparison to work and occupations in corporations. And Kanter says, you know, that numbers really do tend to matter. I made decisions about changing the order of these slides a couple times. Oh, we lost a slide there, I think. Oh, well. All right. We lost this. You think it's the next one? Is it that cartoon?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, there it is. Okay. Thank you. When I ask people, at the end of an interview, is there anything you want to talk about that we haven't asked you about? A couple of people, including one woman who labeled herself a very conservative person, said, I hope this research isn't intended to create quotas. We don't want quotas of women. What we really need is just good coaches. And you don't want to create quotas. And I said, I don't think that's what the goal of this is for me. I don't think we need quotas. I think we need, kids want good coaches and families want good coaches. But I think it's also true that numbers do matter. And the research by Kanter, I think, really supports this. When she studied corporations, she said, you know, corporations where you have 15% or less women, the few women in there suffer from the limitations of being tokens. They have this sort of heightened visibility. They can only sort of survive by using these very narrow sorts of strategies that don't necessarily benefit all women and don't necessarily change the culture and values of the organization, but somehow create a little niche for them to survive within. But when you get into an to a point where you have 16 to 35% women in an organization, that's what she called a tilted organization, where you have the development or the possibility of the development of women's informal networks. You have the possibility of the development of shifts in workplace culture that makes it more conducive for women to thrive. And I would add more conducive for different kinds of men to thrive. And this is a whole other lecture and a chapter in the book. But one of the things I argue in the book is that there's that the sort of narrowing conception of what coaches should be like ends up pushing certain men out as well. And that you get, by the time you get up to age 12, 13, 14, kids, teams, you have a very narrow conception of what a coach is supposed to be, and it only fits a certain type of man. And a lot of the men who really like kids and like working with kids and like sports kind of drop out, just as many of the women drop out because of that sort of narrowing conception of that. So in the skewed organizations, you get the few women who survive and thrive tend to be, as I pointed out, like Dolores Quintero, I think kind of heroic, but they tend to be viewed maybe by other people in the same way that many people, you know, years ago viewed Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher, you know, who was the Prime Minister of Britain and, you know, one of the few women heads of a major Western country. But what a lot of people said about her was that she was more masculine than all of the men around her in the world. You know, she was more masculine than Reagan and others at the time, and tough as nails and all of that. And whether you think that's good or whether that's bad, essentially she's positioned as kind of an honorary fictive male rather than as someone who's out there really changing the political world in a way that opens it up for women. With AYSO, in my community, you see it moving into that realm of being a tilted organization, where you see these beginnings of a network, beginnings of women mentoring each other, beginnings of women starting to bring each other in. So here's my real coming in for a landing. And what I want to talk about for just the last couple of minutes is why this really matters. And I think, again, as I said, probably a lot of you know all this already, but as I said, I kind of want to get on a soapbox for the last 2 minutes here and talk about why it really matters to get more women. Not because we want to impose a quota on youth sports, but for several reasons. First, because it's just plain fair to make the youth sports more open to women coaches. It's not true that we don't have women coaches because they don't volunteer. I know several women women who tried to volunteer and didn't get chosen, who got routed into team mom positions and said, oh, well, okay, I guess that's the only thing I can do, but I really wanted to coach. There are several women who I've given you examples of who start coaching and then get out because they find it to be an inhospitable and chilly climate. It would be just fair to these women to allow them a chance and to create the climate in a way that it makes it more comfortable for them. Secondly, having more women coaches would be really good for communities. And I say this because there's a whole generation of women out there who have a tremendous amount of athletic knowledge and skill to pass on. There are sometimes, I've heard, there were some years in Little League Baseball in my community where they couldn't find enough coaches. And they go to the last year's yearbook and they just start calling up dads who are assistant coaches. And if women were on that list, they would have a whole lot more people to draw from. So there's all that knowledge, all that skill, all that ability, and in many cases willingness. And it's good to sort of tap into that knowledge and skill for the community. Third, it's very good for families, I think, for women to get involved more in coaching. This is complicated, I think, in a lot of ways because of the way modern families have to negotiate their time with each other, sort of negotiating across careers and family and volunteer work and youth sports and all of that sort of stuff that keeps people so busy and running around. But one of the things I found was, at least in professional class families, which is mostly what I was studying in this community, is that there's really an unfinished feminist revolution in this society that we've changed so many things in terms of the way where our occupations are now and professions are open to women. It's quite a different world out there in many professions from what it was when I was a kid and before that, opened up to women in a lot of ways. But as we know, there's still a lot less change in families. Yeah, there's measurable amounts of increase in the amount of time that men spend with their children now compared to a generation or two ago, but it's not so true, not so dramatically true of housework. There still is a sort of second shift that working women often have to tackle when they have a job outside the home and then find that they're still doing 70-80% of the housework and child care at home. So there's this disjuncture between this idea of equal opportunity for women and the way that fits with our work and family life. And the youth sports divisions of labor that I found, where most teams are headed by men who are in these kind of honorary father positions, and then most of the women who volunteer end up becoming the, quote, team moms, really replicate this traditional division of labor that echoes and then reinforces the unfinished revolution in our families and in our communities. So moving towards more gender equity in youth sports, I think, will have a reciprocal effect on helping to continue to move forward towards more gender equity in workplaces and families. Fourth, I think it's very good for boys to be confronted with and to experience powerful women in their lives. Now, it's true that a lot of boys have women teachers and they're around their moms and so forth in many cases, so they have women authority figures in their lives. But I think it's also important that boys learn early on to respect the physical abilities and skills of adult women and girls as well. Boys are moving into a world where they're going to be working side by side with women co-workers, where they're going to have women bosses in many cases. And if they don't have a full understanding and a range of respect for women, part of which can be learned through sports, and there's been a lot of talk about that, about racial equality as well, I think that they're going to become adults and some of them will have problems with this, especially if boys and men's sports continues to be have some of the same sort of cultural aspects that it's had since I was a kid, which is, I think, sometimes shot through with a certain amount of misogyny and sexist joking about girls and women and put downs of boys that you throw like a girl and things like that, that the culture of boys' sports needs to change in order for boys to learn to develop more respect for women. And part of that, I think, not the sole answer, but part of that, I think, is building more respect and openness for women coaches. And then finally, this is probably the part that you all would have just guessed to start with, but I think it's good for girls to, and this is what a lot of the women coaches talked about, that they want to be role models for girls, that they want to encourage girls to become coaches themselves, and that they want their daughters and other girls in the community to see that women are competent as athletes and are knowledgeable and can be leaders in sports. I'll end with a final quote again from my famous quotee, Dolores Quintero, the gamer softball coach, who was telling me at the end of the interview I did with her that she gives this little speech to her girls on the team. She says, "It's one of those speeches I always have for my teams. Girls, please, we need you in this game. Come back and give your time to other girls. If you love this game, then teach it to somebody younger than you. Officiate the game, become a student of the game, and really pass that along. Someday, most of you girls are going to be moms. You don't want to just let dad do all that stuff. Not when you've got this kind of experience. You want to do it too." And it's with Dolores Quintero's words that I will end, and thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you, Dr. Messner, for providing some insights into the complexities of the many barriers that coaches face. Females that are currently in coaching and females that many of our students want to get into coaching. So just I thought we might do our own mini experiment here just for 30 seconds. So since you mentioned the stoppers, the cyclers, and the gamers, so people that have are currently coaching or have coached, if that stands true for you, just stand up. If you've coached or have coached at some point, please stand up. Okay, so everyone just take a look around. We can do a quick gender count here, but I think we have maybe an overrepresentation of females in the room. So give yourselves a hand, coaches. All right, I know that you have incited a lot of questions, so we're going to move into our question and answer phase for the next 10 minutes. And we have Aaron and Austin positioned strategically in the aisle, so if you keep your comments brief and your questions brief so we can get to as many questions as possible, that would be appreciated. Just raise your hand if you have a question, and Aaron and Austin will come down the aisle for you.
I just have a question about, were a majority of the coaches you interviewed, were they coaching girls' teams? As a mom of two boys and a five-year-old who's counting the years until he's able to play football, I'd love to coach football. I don't know if it's going to happen. But I just think, did you see any differences between that in terms of their perceptions and challenges and so on?
Most of the women coaches that I interviewed were coaching girls' teams, but not all. There were some who were coaching boys' soccer and boys' baseball and t-ball, but at the youngest ages. No women were coaching older boys' baseball teams. And no women were coaching the oldest boys' soccer teams either, so they tended to be clustered down at the younger ages. The gamers, the women who went all the way through in softball and in soccer, were coaching girls. Now, there's a lot of interesting stuff. It would be hard for me to go into it now at this time, but there's a lot of interesting stuff that came out in the interviews because I asked all of the coaches, men and women, to talk about boys and girls and their perceptions of boys and girls and whether the boys and girls, in their view, would benefit from having a male coach or a women coach, and if so, why. So I really got into the adults' views of children and gender, and you know, to try to put it in a fairly complicated discussion into a very quick nutshell, what I found was that people have a really sophisticated way of talking about girls today. That I think feminism has really changed the way we think about and talk about girls, and part of that is that parents really are confident that they know sports are really good for daughters, and it fits into their sense that daughters are going to go out into the world and be faced with challenges and have to make choices about how to navigate and straddle public life and family life and so forth. So they have very sophisticated narratives about their daughters. And then when you ask them about boys and their sons, it's as though they are almost without words. It's like they hem and they haw and they try to figure out something coherent to say about boys. And then they finally settle into something very cliche sometimes about how boys are, oh, they're just all full of that testosterone, you know, and essentially boys they see as very kind of linear. They haven't really thought that much about boys and gender, and I think it's part of, again, that sort of unfinished feminist revolution is we haven't really rethought the world of boys very much, and we just, a lot of parents just tend to assume sports are just naturally good for boys. Boys are destined for careers. They're naturally aggressive, and you know, what they're really missing there is the range among boys, including my oldest son, who taught me a lot by not liking sports, and it was stunning to me as somebody who always played a lot of sports and loved sports, and he was very hurt by sports and didn't feel competent. And you know, the last time I went to a ballpark with him was to watch his younger brother play one time, and Miles, my older son, said, "Oh, I have a lot of memories of this place." And I said, "What are your memories?" And he said, striking out, and then striking out again, and then having to walk back to the dugout after I struck out again. And it was not a happy thing that he was saying. And so I think a lot of boys drop out. A lot of boys are not happy with the sort of way that the system kind of starts constraining them and shaping them into a certain kind of male. And I think that's one of the main findings in my research, I think, is that real lack of coherent thought that we as adults have so far about our boys.
My question has to do, and I'm over here.
I'm sorry, I can't see you. Oh, okay. Yeah.
My question has to do, did you look at co-ed teams? Were there any co-ed teams where there was that problem with finding coaches?
Almost no co-ed teams in the leagues, other than in the first year of baseball and t-ball, there'd be just a few girls playing in these otherwise mostly boys teams. When my first son started AYSO back in the early to mid-90s, I was told that the first 2 years were co-ed. And I was actually very pleased with this. But then when we got to our first practice, my glee at finding that we had a woman coach was tempered by the fact that I found that they had just then decided to sex segregate the youngest kids. And so there was no co-ed in either of these leagues, other than the t-ball. The first-year T-ball. Anyone else?
Yeah. How committed or successful were the gamers? I'm sorry, sir.
I can't see. Oh, I see. Okay. Yeah, I just got lights in my eyes.
How committed or successful were the gamers in getting other women involved in coaching?
The few gamers that were in softball hardly thought about it at all, other than to talk to their girls on the teams. To talk to them about becoming coaches, but they were not the type of people who were into networking and trying to recruit other women. They were very much rugged individualists, the ones who were the softball coaches. And I'm talking about a very small number of people. But in soccer, they were there were a couple of them especially who were viewed by the other women coaches who didn't have as much experience as being this sort of nucleus at the beginning of this sort of old girls network. And they were very, very conscious about recruiting other women, and they were somewhat successful in recruiting other women. And I can't really draw a clear cause and effect sort of conclusion from this, but those numbers I showed you of the soccer that kind of swept up at the last 3 or 4 years, the numbers of women in soccer, I think that really had to at least be partly a result of the gamers in soccer forming that sort of nucleus of a women's network and recruiting and mentoring the first and second year women and trying to get them to stay in. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
Did you notice that the female coaches had any different strategies that they used when coaching boys as opposed to coaching girls?
Well, a few of the women and several of the men that I interviewed had coached both boys and girls, so they were able to talk about that, but not very many of the women actually were able to talk about that because they just hadn't done both. One of the things I found was that I really have a lot more data from the men on that, unfortunately, just not that much from the women. And so I can tell you more what the men said. And what the men said was when they coach boys and they coach girls, that they use emotions in very different sorts of ways. They said, when I coach girls, I can't yell at them because they get upset, they cry. So I need to motivate them in different sorts of ways. But the boys, I can yell at them. In fact, if I get right in their face, it really works well, and they respond very, very well to it. And they don't get upset. They just, you know, do what I tell them to do. And it really, this really struck me as very interesting because, again, having sat through several years of Little League Baseball and watching it from the early ages of, you know, 5, 6-year-olds all the way up to 14, one of the things I saw was the emotional development of boys in all of those years. And what I saw was, you know, 5, 6, 7-year-old boys who they scrape their knee or they strike out and make a bad play bursting into tears, you know, very upset. And you know, the coaches would go over and console them sometimes for a moment. And then boys 7, 8, 9, hurting themselves, striking out, once in a while, still crying a little bit, and getting a very brief sort of pat on the back from the coach. But then when those sort of middle-aged kids boys cry, what happens is the team creates a space for them in the dugout where they can go sit for a second and console themselves. And it's almost as though, we'll just ignore this and let you have your space for a minute until you stop crying, you know. And then the boys eventually get, you know, control themselves and stop crying. And then by the time you get up into the higher ages, 11, 12, but especially 13, 14, there is no crying in baseball. What there is boys have learned by then to convert those kinds of feelings into an appropriate masculine sort of expression, which is usually anger. And so the boy who otherwise would have been crying 3, 4 years before takes his bat and throws it against the screen. He curses, and the coach might have to bark at him, you know, and say, okay, we don't want to hear any of that, you know. And so what's happening is what, you know, the psychologist William Pollack calls the hardening of boys. It's a social process through which boys learn to not to express those kinds of feelings. It's not appropriate. And then the coach who gets in boys' face and yells at them because says it doesn't bother them, well, it's true. I mean, he's seeing something very real. The boys have learned to respond to that kind of coaching. But the conclusion that it doesn't bother them, I think, it has to be looked at in a little more complicated way, because I think those feelings are still there, but they've been repressed and kind of sublimated, I guess, if you want to use a Freudian term, kind of sublimated into anger and into actions. So coaches are able to sort of utilize that by getting them to divert those feelings. So, but what kind of boys and men are we creating by sort of layering on top of that rather than changing that? So that was my main finding in terms of coaches' different approaches to coaching boys and girls that on the emotional level. But I didn't get a lot of that from women because I just didn't interview very many who did both.
I had a question. You mentioned that...
Can you wave at me so I can see where you are? Oh, I see.
Hi.
Okay, thank you.
That acting tough was a strategy that these women used to navigate the youth sport system. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering if you got a sense of, are these the same women who act tough on and off the field? So is it that they've learned to act tough and look that part in other contexts and bring that to sport? Or is there something particularly empowering about the sport context that allows these women to act and look tough that they wouldn't otherwise in their lives?
That's a great question. I'm not sure I can answer it definitively other than to just sort of think about a couple of examples of the really tough women some of whom I quoted here. And they did talk a little bit, although I didn't take the interview in that direction very much, but they did talk a little bit about having to extend that kind of toughness sometimes into their occupational lives. And they did talk also, a couple of them, about having learned that from their fathers. They'd say, my father, and these tended to be Latina women. It's an interesting thing, too, is that most of the gamers I interviewed who were the toughest women were not white women. They were Latinas, they were Asian American and South Asian and Filipina women. And it's really kind of interesting to me to think about, you know, some of the sort of really thin cultural stereotypes that we sometimes have about Latinas and Asian women, that they're living in these patriarchal sort of very patriarchal families, and so they have to be very deferential to their men. They weren't in my community. They were the ones who were the toughest in my community. So I can't remember, there's another half of what I was going to say, but I guess I've kind of lost that part of it. So sorry, can you repeat the last part of your question? Because I know there was something I was going to respond to.
Yeah, it was just the sense of whether or not, and kind of getting at the Latino, like saying maybe they're bringing some of their toughness to the sport context.
Right.
Versus, like, is there something about the sport context that's particularly empowering that allows women to be tough?
Yeah.
Yeah,
I don't know, because I think the other part of that I was going to say is that a lot of these women are, I think, in their professional lives, very tough women, but it doesn't seem for them to translate over into sports very well. Now, whether learning to be tough in sports translates the other direction, I really can't say from my research. I would think it might, but I don't have any sort of data. I didn't explore that.
Well, let's give another big round of applause for Dr. Messner. So to conclude the evening, obviously the scarcity and the lack of female coaches at all levels of sport is something that those of us in the Tucker Center care very deeply about, and a lot of the work that has been inspired by Mike's work in the last couple years is ongoing, and some of that is in the lobby that you can take a look at. And Dr. Messner has been gracious enough to sign his books for those